Let us discuss one of the theoretical perspectives in sociology, that is the subaltern perspective. To understand this perspective, we need to first understand what is subaltern. Here are some of the definitions that you can take a look and understand what are subalterns, what is this a class, was it a group, how did they become a part of the process of nationalism in India, and what was the role of various proponents of this perspective. So here are some definitions. Please quickly take a look and then we can start with the introduction. First important point is that this term subaltern was coined by Antonio Gramsci. So what is subaltern? It is nothing but it is a group of people. Okay, they can belong to various tribes, they can belong to the peasants group, they can belong to the artist groups, who are generally excluded from the state power. Okay, so now we know that we live in a democracy and everybody has a universal franchise and everybody has the equal right of representation. Okay, that is democracy. But what happened in earlier times was some of the groups were excluded from state power and they had to fight for their rights and they had a fight against the whole society. It was one group versus the whole society which were against them. So if we talk about the term subaltern, literally, if we talk about it, what it means in English, it is a view from below. Okay, so a view from below here means understanding from the bottom of the society, because they are at the grassroots level, they are at the bottom level, who were generally marginalized, they were generally excluded because people thought, what do they know? They are illiterates, they should not have a voice, they should not have a say in politics. Okay, so they were excluded. But when the flow of knowledge is from below, when the flow of knowledge is from the people who were marginalized, that is subaltern. Now, they were not only excluded and marginalized because they belonged to a certain class, but this exclusion was also on various other parameters like caste, gender. So, they were excluded and they were silenced in the world of politics because they could not make up with the people who were rich, who were the elites, who were the powerful people, who were the educated, who were the modern people, those who were very good in pretending that we know very well, and therefore the people who are excluded should remain excluded. And what happens as a result is when you are excluded from politics, because politics is something that is directly related to your rights, to your knowledge, to your awareness. So when you are excluded from politics and when you are silenced in the world of politics, then your rights suffer, your living standard suffers, and the whole group suffers. So how did this emerge? You know that necessity is the mother of invention, right? So there was a need. Ideas and ideologies were there in abundance in the society at that time when we were under the British rule. But there were a lot of problems happening in the society which were directly creating issues in the social existence of people. Okay, for example, today because of various forces, if I'm not able to exercise my rights in the society, my existence, my social existence will suffer. So the ideas and ideologies of the society should favor each and everyone, should be for the greater good. It should not be biased. Therefore, it was important to understand and to restore the balance of highlighting the role of politics of the masses as against the elites who thought that they were the people who were only supposed to hold power. And according to them, the others were not to be included. The masses did not have a role. So there was the whole problem, the undermining of the role of politics of the masses. So this subaltern historiography, it relied on the basic concept of restructuring the history. But what kind of history?
the other kind of history, not the only kind of history we study, that is the imperial kind of study, where only the rich, educated and powerful people, they were included in that kind of history. But no, the history of people's politics and their attempt, the attempt of these classes to organize themselves and to create their own history. Okay, so once they are included in the history, once they are included in the decision making, in the politics, then they organize themselves and they create their own history. So when we talk about subaltern perspective in India, it was a new school in the field of Indian history writing. And some of the important proponents of this perspective, which we will study one by one in different lectures, are Ranjit Guha, David Hardiman, Ambedkar, Kapil Kumar and many more. So when we talk about subaltern perspective in India, it basically comprised of the peasants and the tribal class. Now mind you, according to those times when they were not organized, they did not have the consciousness, they did not have the awareness, and they were also illiterate. So it was very difficult for them to organize themselves and become a class. But what the people used to do, the elites used to do, they used to use them like objects to create their history. For example, they used to lure them with something in vote bank politics for gimmicks. They used to give themselves and they used to earn a vote. So these kind of things have happened a lot, and therefore they were just, you know, objects in history. But once they organized themselves, they started creating their own history and they also started becoming a part of Indian nationalism. The role of Ranjit Guha, who was an Indian historian, his role is very immense. He established the subaltern studies project and he is the one to be credited with subaltern studies in India. Therefore, it was a very important approach to study the tribal and peasant movements. For example, when David Hardiman studied the Devi movement, it was a tribal movement and it was very important to understand why some kind of movements happened and how they organized themselves and how they fought against the elites. It is also very important to note that the incorporation of the voice of the weak helped in the rewriting of history where the masses were included. Now, these subaltern classes not only include tribals but also the landless laborers, the peasants, artisans and other poor as well. Okay, and the resistance that they showed, when they organized themselves and gained consciousness, was against the rich peasants or urban traders and the revenue administrators who were treating them merely as objects. With respect to the post-colonialism, subaltern means the populations outside the hegemonic power of the structure of the colony. Okay, so when colonies were established and the populations which were excluded from the power, who were excluded from the homeland on the basis of their social structure, on the basis of their political features or their regional or geographical features, that is what subaltern meant with respect to post-colonialism. Now let us discuss some questions. Question number one, which of the following statements correctly identify subaltern perspective? So if you look at option number C, it says approach history from below. So yes, it is correct. When you are talking about the masses, you are studying history from below. Focused more on what happens among the masses at the base level of the society. So the right answer will be option C. Question number two, which of the following best describes the subaltern in post-colonialism? So that was just what is subaltern, but what is subaltern in post-colonialism is asked here in question number two. So if you look at option C, refers to populations that are marginalized or outside the hegemonic power structures. The answer will be option C. I hope you got the lecture. Thank you very much for watching.